now I'm going to introduce our speaker. Jeffrey Tumlin is Principal and Director of Strategy for Nelson Nygaard, and is an expert in helping communities move from discord to agreement about the future. For more than 20 years, Jeff has led award-winning plans in cities from Seattle and Vancouver to Moscow and Abu Dhabi. He helps balance all modes of transportation in complex places to achieve a community's wider goals and best utilize their limited resources. He has developed transformative plans throughout the world that accommodate millions of square feet of growth with no net increase in motor vehicle traffic. He is a dynamic and frequent guest speaker. I've seen him many times, and so I'm very excited that he's here tonight. And he's the author of Sustainable Transportation Planning, Tools for Creating Healthy, Vibrant, and Resilient Communities. Please join me in giving Jeff a warm welcome.
Thanks, Michelle. So my name is Jeff Tumlin, and I do like to ride the train. But I'm not here to talk to you tonight about trains. Let me back up a little bit. So although I've lived in the San Francisco Bay Area for the last 28 years, I was born in Los Angeles. And growing up in the 1970s in LA, I spent a lot of time in cars. I did not spend very much time on trains, but like all little boys growing up anywhere, I was kind of fascinated by all modes of transportation. I was a very early transport nerd. Well, the thing that really, really fascinated me was driving, in part because growing up in the 1970s in LA, I watched a lot of television, and television taught me many of the most important things that I know, including that someday buying my own private automobile would bring me power and freedom and autonomy and social status and someday, eventually, maybe even sex, which is really the thing that is used to sell private automobiles. And as I was growing up, my first job was actually working in Disneyland. And Walt Disney was really the ultimate transport nerd. Like, Disneyland is a complete celebration of every imaginable mode of transportation, and every single one is fun. And although I worked on the submarine Voyage ride, the submarine Voyage is tucked underneath what is basically the only ride at Disneyland that remains completely unchanged from its 1955 original. And that is the Autopia ride, still as popular today as it was in 1955 before the interstate freeway system was invented. And the Autopia ride actually comes straight out of three of the most popular, most visited industrial exhibits in the history of the world. And those were the Futurama exhibits at the 1933, 1939, and 1964 World's Fairs. And I would encourage you to actually go to YouTube and Google Futurama 1939 and marvel at this vision of the city of the future. It was a completely transformative vision. I mean, we've just sort of come out of the Great Depression, and General Motors sponsored this exhibition that showed that not only could we have a chicken in every pot, but a car in every garage, and this limitless mobility would completely transform American society. That limitless mobility would deliver us an unprecedented kind of freedom. And indeed, I would argue that the interstate freeway system that came out of this vision of the city was arguably the best infrastructure investment that this country ever made. Indeed, it transformed this massive, disjointed country, uniting it in a way and providing for a level of mobility that no human society had ever seen before or really since, allowing people to move vast distances safely in quick periods of time, allowing disparate economic centers to unite economically by being able to ship goods from one part of the country to another, allowing mass migrations with each generation able to move two states to the west, and really bringing this country together economically in a way that no one had ever really imagined before. And part of that promise of the interstate freeway system was not only the sort of limitless mobility in order to sort of pack up your bags and move from Oklahoma to Los Angeles, as my ancestors did, but also to be able to live in the big house far away and to commute to your job in the city center. That part of the interstate freeway system vision was actually not a part of the original vision of the system. In fact, Eisenhower himself said, "We never intended to build freeways in city centers. This is a complete disaster." And many of us who were promised, both from these General Motors-sponsored Futurama exhibits, but also from our automobile television commercials, that being able to drive would mean limitless mobility. And indeed, whenever you see a car commercial, like there's only one car in the road, right? And you drive as fast as you want. Is it any wonder that every time we're stuck in horrific traffic congestion, as any of us are who has to drive to work any significant distance in this region, is it any wonder that we are deeply disappointed, that somehow we feel cheated of this thing that we were promised, that we still believe in, this vision of the city of the future, straight from the Jetsons, straight from this 1933 technologist view, that if we provide just enough roadway capacity, everyone could drive an unlimited amount without any view of having to suffer real consequences? So, in our disappointment, every time a vote comes up for a transportation sales tax, we're promised that surely just raising another few billion dollars out of another quarter cent, surely that adding just one or six more lanes to those freeways will finally solve our traffic congestion problem once and for all, because surely something needs to be done. The status quo is intolerable. We've got to do something. The trouble is that doing something without thinking through all of the consequences, of course, doesn't always result in the best outcomes. And this is a unique problem. Well, it's not a unique problem, actually, in transportation. It's a unique problem in how we think about transportation. Because if we were to look at sort of any other good or commodity in society, how many of you like ice cream? Like, I like ice cream. Most children that I know love ice cream. And a national policy to promote children's happiness, one could argue, would be to mandate unlimited free ice cream to all children in America. And most likely this would, result, at least in the short term, in a net increase, a significant net increase in childhood happiness. It might also have other unintended negative consequences, like severe childhood obesity, or an astronomical price for cheese, or having to demolish our national forests in order to provide additional grazing land for all of the cattle that would be necessary in order to support unlimited ice cream for children. And yet, one could also imagine that if government had such a program and we were experiencing the unintended negative consequences of such a program, that advocates for children's happiness would say, there's got to be something else we can do. We can make the kids exercise more, or we can make the cows more efficient through genetic modification in order to increase milk production in order to continue creating more ice cream. Sadly, those programs probably wouldn't result in the desire to have both unlimited free ice cream and no unintended consequences. The same sort of thinking also applies in business.
It requires very, very careful attention to a whole number of factors, including how much I pay my employees, the sort of benefits that I provide, how often I upgrade their computers, how we establish our billing rates with our clients, how much we invest in marketing and research and development. It's all very challenging for us to balance all of these competing needs. And I know that if perhaps I tried to beat my employees in order to make them more productive, that might work for, maybe an hour or so. But obviously, if I kept doing that, my employees would quickly abandon me and my business would suffer. Transportation is a far more complex system than running a small business or establishing a national policy for the proper pricing of ice cream. And yet, we continue as a people to apply what I would call object thinking to our transportation systems, rather than what we would call systems thinking. In systems thinking, when you take an action, it has many subsequent additional actions that are either required or are created. But there are cascading effects of our decisions. And those cascading effects may have feedback loops that either accentuate our problem or create new problems that are worse than the problems that we are trying to solve. In much of my work, what I try to do is to allow normal human beings to understand how transportation works. Most of my industry has spent a lot of time trying to make you all think that it's super complicated science. It's not really. It's also not really best seen as a branch of civil engineering. Highway design is absolutely a branch of civil engineering. Transportation is really, though, much better seen as a branch of economics. All we do in transportation is try to predict human behavior and accommodate it. And indeed, mobility itself serves no independent utility. In transportation, all we do is provide investment strategies for places to achieve their larger goals. The primary impact of transportation investments is actually an increase in land value. That's the biggest effect that transportation investments have. That, of course, creates cascading effects because increasing land value creates the opportunity for new development. And we'll get to those relationships in a second. So the problem with my industry, which is that we have very, very complicated tools in order to do transportation analysis. And these tools are intentionally opaque. Most of them are, in fact, based upon theory rather than empirical evidence. So we run many, many, many traffic demand analyses. But nobody ever, ever comes back 5 years after the project is built to ask us, so Jeff, you ran the traffic numbers for that project, and well, it's built now. Can you go back and check to see how your predictions compare with reality? We don't have to do that. Other industries, however, do have to do that. And we, in transportation, learn a lot from the medical industry because it, in fact, collects a lot of empirical data and always tests its theories against actual empirical measurement. If pharmaceutical makers are making a lot of money off of a drug, but it's killing the patients, those drug manufacturers will be made to stop issuing that drug. In transportation, we don't have to stop issuing the drug. One of the points of data that the health industry has been collecting for many years is the rates of obesity in the United States. These are maps from the Centers for Disease Control in Atlanta, and you can see the darker blue states, you know, 10 to 14% of adults clinically obese in 1985. And as the trends continue over time, you can see that we have to keep changing the scale in various years. Here in 1997, over 20% of adults obese in Mississippi. In 2001, it's now over 25% of adults in Mississippi. 2006, we've got to change the scale again. 2008, 2009, over 30% of adults in the lower Mississippi clinically obese. And while correlation is not the same as causation, and that there are many causes at the root of America's epidemic of adult and childhood obesity problems and all of the other health impacts that come along with that, the strongest correlation we find between both adult and childhood obesity is the rate of daily exercise that people get. Obviously, diet plays a significant role, but there's an even stronger role for many of us in how much daily exercise we're getting. There's an even stronger relationship between how much daily exercise we get and whether we can walk or bike for our basic needs of daily life. If people have to drive to the gym in order to walk or run on a treadmill, they're very unlikely to get the required 10,000 steps a day that our bodies need for optimal functioning. But people who live in more walkable areas, including people who are just walking to the bus stop every day, basically get the sort of activity that the body needs for optimal functioning, and they're able to maintain a reasonable body mass index. Now, so This is one of the reasons why many of my friends who are in the medical industry complain that we in the transportation sector have far more control over positive public health outcomes than the medical industry does. Because in our world, we control prevention. Basically, all the medical industry can do is figure out what to do with you once your body is already experiencing all of the problems that it faces by carrying extra weight. Diabetes, cardiovascular disease, joint trouble. There's a whole long list of pretty complicated symptoms the body suffers if we're carrying too much weight. Some of the more interesting research, though, about the relationship between health and transportation is actually occurring in the mental health professions. And this is particularly fascinating to me. So this complicated molecule on the screen is a neuropeptide called oxytocin. And oxytocin is part of a family of chemicals that the brain produces. Like dopamine makes me feel happy. It's a pleasure chemical. There's others I won't get into it, but oxytocin is interesting to me in that it is effectively the biological basis of trust. It's the chemical that allows us to believe that if I scratch your back, you will someday scratch mine. It's the chemical that allows us to bond deeply with other people, including people that we're not related to. And it is released in the brain under very specific and limited circumstances. So it's released when we gaze longingly into the eyes of somebody that we love. It's released most prominently during breastfeeding and orgasm, for obvious reasons. But it is also released, most interestingly, in outdoor exercise. Exercising outdoors releases small and steady amounts of oxytocin. Not exercising indoors, and scientists don't understand why this happens. And yet, we have all experienced this phenomenon. When you've had a horrible argument with your spouse or an awful day at the office, you're feeling really frustrated and people are bugging you, and you go outside and you go for a run or a bike ride or a brisk walk, suddenly the world changes. There's a variety of chemicals at play, but one of those chemicals that is at play is the release of oxytocin. It is not the world changing, it's your brain chemistry changing, and suddenly making the world seem like a completely different place. And it's quite remarkable, and it happens to all of us of every age. And it's the sort of thing that can actually build up in our system if we get this sort of activity regularly, and makes us happier, more loving, more trustful people, better able to fulfill responsibility in civic society, to participate in the democratic process, to participate in your churches or in your city councils. And so it is also in marked contrast to the whole other array of chemicals that get released when we're stuck in our cars, particularly in traffic congestion. Now, the human body is just an amazing system. And so much of who we are and how we interact with the world, you can attribute in many ways to evolutionary biology. The physical design tolerance of the human body is about 18 miles an hour. If you're hit by a car at less than that, you're going to be bruised, you may break a bone, but you'll be able to walk away for the most part. If you're hit by a car at a speed significantly higher than that, you're going to have some catastrophic. Similarly, the way we interact with the world is governed by the fact that we are fundamentally tribal social primates. Our species has lived in groups for a long, long time. And we send an immense amount of social information to each other under all kinds of different circumstances. You know, you right now are kind of watching my body language, you're looking if I'm making eye contact with you, you're seeing, you know, how I move my shoulders and my hands, you're judging about whether I'm saying the truth or not. You know, is this guy BSing us or does he have something interesting to say? The same thing occurs when you're navigating a crowded space. If you're on a crowded sidewalk in, you know, downtown San Jose or in Manhattan, despite the fact that, you know, there's these swirls of people, you could send signals to everyone else around you of your intended direction. And people will sort of subtly kind of move out of their way and make adjustments. Nothing needs to be said. You don't need to turn signals on your belt. But if you happen to run into somebody, you don't have to sort of stop and issue a formal apology. You can, you know, shrug your shoulders, you can duck your head. There's a dozen different gestures that signal, oh, I'm sorry, that was unintentional, please forgive me. As well as a dozen other different silent gestures that say, oh, no problem, I forgive you, or, you know, hey buddy, don't do that again. When we're driving at 60 miles an hour, surrounded by a carapace of steel and glass in our cars, all of that rich social information that we're used to receiving in our normal lives, in our social lives, that information is shut off. And so you're driving your car down the freeway, and somebody cuts you off. This person may have no idea why he's just cut you off, but in the meantime, this person has triggered a reaction in your brain. Two important factors, two very primitive factors, are threatened in you. Your safety — this person clearly had a callous disregard for your safety, making you, you know, put on your brakes or risk crashing into him. And in addition, this person has threatened your social status. Somebody of your importance clearly should not be cut off, right? Yes? So, you know, you demand a response from this person. Hey, buddy, you know, perhaps you use a handy gesture to express your discontent with this person. Now, this person driving 65 miles an hour, you know, distracted on his phone, whatever, has no idea that he's upset you, has no idea that, you know, you're trying to enter into an argument with him, and he does not respond. Your brain then triggers a natural escalation. Now he's just really insulted your social status. Here you are demanding, you know, an apology or some sort of response, and he's just completely blown you off. So your brain enters into full fight or flight response, and it triggers a cascade of chemicals in your body, all of which are perfectly designed to help you escape from a saber-toothed tiger that happens to be chasing you, right? So your muscles tense, right? Blood goes to the extremities. You tense yourself, your center of gravity automatically goes lower. Your voice lowers in the register. More importantly, your whole thinking process changes. Now, your thinking process speeds up in order to facilitate reaction, but the prefrontal cortex of the brain literally shuts down. That whole part, that front part of the brain, cut off from the rest of the brain. The part of the brain that allows us to think through the consequences of our actions. Now, if you're being chased by a saber-toothed tiger, the mental process of thinking through the consequences of your actions is time-consuming. You don't want to do that. You need to react. You need to run. You don't want to think about, oh, well, you know, what will people think about me if I run like a girl or something? No, just like run, get out of there, do something now, right? So those same brain responses that served us so well for millions of years out on the savannah don't serve us quite so well in the automobile. And these chemicals that get released in our brains that are so effective in helping us to elude a saber-toothed tiger are our enemy when they're released every day in the car, because these chemicals have consequences. So how many of you have done or said something behind the wheel of a car that you would have never, ever done under any other circumstances? Like, I certainly have, right? We use language that we never use in any other context. I have actively gone out of my way to try to harm other people, right? You know, I've driven recklessly in my rage at somebody having, you know, insulted me in the car. This is craziness. And yet, we've all done it. And when our brain does that every single day, we're stuck in traffic congestion in our cars every single day, it actually results in permanent changes to the brain. Road rage is actually a clinical term. And the chemical changes that it forces upon the brain actually makes us less trustful, angrier, shorter tempered, less capable of thinking through the consequences of our actions, you know, unhappier. Just every bad symptom that you could think of is caused by our brains, by having us forcibly cut off from the social signals that we use in order to navigate the world. And so we wonder, in the world of transportation, why we continue to design communities where all trips are legally required to be by automobile, where it is not a reasonable option for anyone to be able to walk or bike to meet any of the needs of daily life. And you know, this happens in so many different ways in basically every city that I work in. You know, even cities that have really great policy statements about walkability and mix of use and complete streets. Here's a city, this could be anywhere, that has a street that perfectly meets the policy goals, rules, and regulations that it has established for itself. This is a mixed-use community. There's some residential, and there's some employment, and some retail. There's a hotel in the background, right? And each of those uses meets its minimum parking requirement, because you wouldn't want somebody from one use to park in front of another use. That would be really bad. And it meets the level of service threshold established by the city, because congestion is bad. And you know, it meets the landscape requirements and the pedestrian orientation requirement. There's some colored pavement and some nice zigzags there. This is great. And look, there's even a pedestrian. So this place has succeeded perfectly in creating the walkable, mixed-use kind of place that it set out for itself in its policy statements, and that it requires for itself in its parking standards, zoning codes, street design guidance, traffic impact analysis requirements, and so on. And so one of the things that I do every time I go and start working in a new community is go in and look very closely at their adopted policy language, and then identify whether there is perhaps any contradiction between their adopted rosy policy language and the rules, regulations, design requirements, and performance metrics that the poor city's traffic engineers are required to use. And this is the cue to go to the next slide. Oh, there we go. And indeed, in every single city that I've ever worked in, without exception, the rules and regulations directly contradict the policy guidance. And this is particularly true for anything having to do with traffic engineering. And I have a lot of compassion for municipal traffic engineers who have elected officials and citizens very, very angry at the work that the traffic engineers are doing, when the traffic engineers are only following the rules, regulations, design guidance, and performance metrics that the city council has established for them. Those of you in the room who are elected officials or planning commissioners, it is not your local traffic engineer that is responsible for those rules. It's you. You are the ones who have to make sure that your policy language and your rules and regulations are in conformance with each other. So, that's where we start. The first and most important thing that all communities need to make sure they have together, working together, is what we call performance metrics, to make sure that we are measuring success. In my world of transportation, if you're not measuring it, it might as well not exist. What you measure is fundamentally a statement of your values. Right now in transportation, in most communities that I work in, there is one single metric that we use to analyze everything that we're asking the transportation system to deliver. And that's called intersection level of service. I'm sure, how many of you have you've heard of intersection level service or LOS? Right. Everything is a TLA or a three-letter acronym. It's a letter grade system that measures the calculated average seconds of delay that a motor vehicle experiences at an intersection, calculated off of the peak 15 minutes of the peak hour. Got it? Average seconds of delay that a motor vehicle experiences as a result of congestion in the peak hour, calculated off of the peak 15 minutes. Letter grade system, which means basically that each change in letter grade is about an additional 15 seconds of delay. Now, it's important to understand what level service is and what it's not. So it only measures the seconds of delay associated with congestion, not the amount of time that you spend at a red light. It is only a measure of vehicle delay, so that a person on board a 40-person bus is weighted about 1/40th the value of a person driving alone in a car. It does not include bicyclists or pedestrians at all. You might as well not exist. It also, interestingly, has almost nothing to say about how long it takes to drive from A to B. Because in fact, signal delay may be a far more significant component of total delay than congestion-related delay. So it is a very useful metric for those of us who are trying to manage the traffic signal system, to figure out how much green you give one side of the intersection versus another. But it's not a very useful metric for understanding how the transportation system is working. It also has some other consequences, including the assumption that level service F is the same as what you would see on your daughter's elementary school report card. That somehow level service F is failure. Oh, the road doesn't work. Oh, I'm sorry, the intersection fails, so no, you can't have that bike lane. Level service F simply means that in the peak 15 minutes, the peak hour, supply and demand for the roadway come into balance, that they equal each other. That's all level service F means, that you can't get any more cars really through that intersection, at least during that narrow time period. It also means that a street like this one, that has probably four times as much traffic capacity as will ever be used, and is at level service A, just like on your elementary school report card, this is the perfect street. Like the traffic engineer, A plus for this one. Whereas, you know, a street like, say, University Avenue in Palo Alto, which used to have four traffic lanes and now only has two, is the worst failure of a street that any traffic engineer could ever imagine. It is, in fact, at level service F, met most of its intersections for long periods of the day. And the city of Palo Alto could easily solve that problem by just putting those extra lanes back. But there are other values that come into play when we're managing our streets. And for Palo Alto, retail sales are actually something that they care about. That is a transportation performance metric for them, even if they're not measuring it. The fact that retail sales per square foot on University Avenue are among the highest of any place in the entire United States comes into play when they're thinking about how to manage that street. You could get six lanes on University Avenue if you would just get rid of the damn on-street parking and take those silly trees and bulb outs out again. The same is true when we start applying level service thresholds to other modes of transportation. Level service A for pedestrians means you can walk as fast as you would like. So if you're walking past sort of creepy parking lots and boarded up stores and you're the only one out there, that's really the best that we can do for pedestrians. But the crowded sidewalk where you can't quite walk as fast as you want, no, that's really not what we want for pedestrians. So, as you can imagine, how one treats level of service scores really varies depending upon your perspective. With the traffic engineer saying, the University Avenue, horrible failure, does not work, right? Should not be allowed, is a failure, and the overscale street where no one would ever walk and where land values are low, that is awesome. Of course, an economist would say the absolute opposite. An economist would say that if the demand for the roadway equals the supply in the peak 15 minutes of the peak 1 hour, then that roadway is perfectly sized. That if we made that roadway any wider, we would be wasting our investment for the other 95% of the day. And more importantly, that you know the street is supporting what we really want, which is vibrant economic activity, a high quality of life, and a successful place. And the street that's overbuilt is a gross waste of resources, that too much public money went into designing that street, and it's actually detracting from the land value along that street. We did not do well on that street. So thinking about level of service and what it means is important, and what it means varies depending upon your context. Indeed, on a retail street, level of service F is much better than level of service A. Level of service A at a retail street means there's not enough traffic, and that traffic is moving too quickly for cars to be able to pull into a parking space or see a storefront. Level of service E is probably optimal. If you're operating a level of service C at peak, you should probably take away a traffic light. Right? It doesn't work because it's operating at level of service C at peak. We have to make the road narrower. On a more industrial street, we might set a different threshold where the critical time of day aspect of deliveries might say, well, you know, property value isn't as important here and pedestrian accessibility isn't as important. So maybe we want to set a level of service D target or C target in order to facilitate those truck movements. But there are other ways of measuring streets. And one of my favorite publications remarkably comes out of New York City, of all places, under their previous transportation director, Jeanette Sadikon. They produced this remarkable document called Measuring the Street. It's available free online. And you can look at the quantitative approach that they used in order to judge whether changes to their street cross-sections made any sense. The transportation department proposed removing a traffic lane and a parking lane from this critical street near Washington Square. And you know, all of the people, the taxi cab industry and people who drove and the merchants all said, oh, are you crazy? There's already congestion. This is going to be a disaster. You're going to kill the economy. And the transportation department said, well, you know, maybe, but let's just try this. Let's do a pilot for 6 months. We're just going to do it in paint. We can undo it if it doesn't work. And there was grumble, grumble, grumble. They went out and do it. They took away the traffic lane. And lo and behold, they measured an array of interesting metrics, including, for example, speed. So what they found was that speeding, jackrabbiting behavior, actually decreased. So the peak speeds went down. But the median speeds actually went up, because the most prudent drivers now are dictating maximum speed. That related to dramatic improvements in injuries and crashes of all kinds. As the speeds normalized, drivers slowed down, safety improved. But more interestingly, there was a dramatic improvement in retail performance. Traffic was moving more slowly, pedestrians were lingering longer, it felt like a more humane kind of place. And most importantly of all, they actually surveyed people who were using the street, and 74% of them said, this is a lot better. This decided the ultimate configuration for the street, regardless of the implications for intersection level of service. Similarly, New York has been measuring the success of their parklet program, you know, knocking out travel lanes and parking lanes for outdoor seating, noticing that, you know, sure, parking availability, you know, might not be so good, but the stores are doing better, 172% increase in retail sales. Can't complain about that. And other metrics of business success. So your transportation performance metrics are a deep expression of your community's values. And if your values are not quantified, if they're not reflected in how you're measuring the success of the transportation system, they are being completely ignored. And this is not to say eliminate use of intersection level of service. It still is a useful metric, but it's important to put it in its place and to give your traffic engineers useful quantitative metrics and thresholds to help them balance the needs of many competing users and that it use those tools correctly. George Box was sort of the founder of travel demand modeling in the United States. He had a lot of wisdom about these tools. Travel demand models are really useful for comparing alternatives against each other, provided you understand their strengths and their weaknesses. All travel demand models are ultimately an exercise in simplification, of narrowing the variables down to the ones that matter the most, and doing a fairly simple analysis in order to be able to compare alternatives against each other. As a tool for predicting the future, however, they're really no better than tarot cards. Don't expect your traffic engineers to predict the future. do expect them to help you figure out how to compare different choices and what they mean, and also ask smart questions about the variables that are included and excluded from the model. If a variable is not included in the model, it's not going to tell you anything about that. And if the model isn't capable of quantifying outcomes that you care about, you may need a different modeling tool. It's not to say to throw out your existing model. It's probably perfectly good at answering the questions it was designed to ask. One factor that almost all travel demand models are notoriously bad at is factoring in what we call induced demand. So none of us likes sitting in traffic congestion. As we saw before, it literally drives us all crazy. We hate it. And we complain to our city. We demand that the road get widened so that we don't have to sit in traffic congestion. So you all pay your transportation sales tax, raises money, widens the roads. Driving is faster. That's great. We're now happy. We can now we're happy, we can make different choices. So we can say, oh, you know, that great new restaurant that opened across town that we wouldn't have gone to before because we would have been stuck in that horrible congestion, like, why don't we go do that? That's great. Good for the economy, right? You're, you know, widening roads increases economic activity a lot. Widening roads also means, like, oh, honey, you know, why don't we go get that bigger, cheaper house farther away? Because now that they've widened the road, we can still get to work in the same amount of time. So widening roads, making driving faster, has a profound impact on human behavior. It makes us drive more. This is called induced demand. And so when we drive more, the result is congestion, which makes us sad, which makes us complain, and we demand that the roadway get widened again. And that makes driving faster for about 5 minutes. And yet, you know, we've seen this every single time we vote to spend billions of dollars on our freeway widening. You know, within 6 months, all of those freeways are just as congested as they were before they were widened. In fact, almost without exception, the construction delay caused by the highway widening project worsens travel time more than the short-term gain that we get once the roadway is widened. In Los Angeles, one of the, you know, the most expensive highway widening projects in the country, Los Angeles spent over $4 billion, with a B, dollars, widening Interstate 405 through Sepulveda Pass. When they opened the highway, travel time was worse on day one than it was before they started the construction project. This is the law of induced demand at work. Now, there's a famous adage that you can't build your way out of congestion. Traffic congestion is really best seen not as an infrastructure problem, but as an economic problem. Because the primary effect of transportation investments is to change land value, in a place with a dynamic economy like ours, congestion always rises to meet the available supply. That the economy drives us to drive, and we will drive as much as we can tolerate. And our tolerance for congestion is effectively constant as a species. Our average drive time today is about the same as it was in the time of ancient Rome. Nero measured commute time. Commute time was measured in Elizabethan London. About the same. We make choices about where we live and where we work based upon a certain relatively fixed tolerance of how much time we're willing to spend in any mode of transportation. And we adjust our lives accordingly. In this region, because of its superheated economy, people are willing to tolerate even worse commutes over a period of time. But eventually, even that corrects itself, as it did during the recession. Indeed, the only city in this country that has ever permanently solved its traffic congestion problem is Detroit. Traffic congestion is an economic problem. It is not an infrastructure problem. And therefore, the only solutions to traffic congestion are economic solutions, not infrastructure solutions. I can add as many traffic lanes as you want to all those roadways out there, and you'll make a lot of developers a lot of money, but you're not going to solve the traffic congestion problem through roadway widening alone. What you can do is move where the bottlenecks go. That's really what we do in roadway design, is decide where the bottlenecks go. San Francisco rather famously has a policy of constraining Highway 101 and Interstate 80 through downtown San Francisco, because San Francisco wants to be the regional traffic bottleneck, recognizing that if it super, super, super inconveniences the drive through San Francisco from the peninsula to the East Bay, it actually ends up favoring the trip to San Francisco. San Francisco has a congestion promotion policy that is about its economic development interests relative to the region. One of, you know, like, it very San Francisco, right? I mean, so imperious. But also has a lot of wisdom to it. So other things that our travel demand models are notoriously bad at is every line in a travel demand model is a straight line. We assume straight line projections that go on in perpetuity. Total and per capita vehicle miles traveled in the United States has been on a steady rise really since World War II and in a pretty straight line since the early 1970s. What's remarkable though, however, is that dramatic inflection point that you see right in 2005. Now part of that, and a significant component of that, was related to the recession. When the economy collapsed, a lot of particularly young people didn't have the resources to buy cars. It had a big impact on travel behavior. But what is putting all the automobile manufacturers in a panic is that that per capita vehicle miles traveled line is not recovering with the economy. And particularly when you start parsing it by geography and by demographics, it is making the automobile industry very concerned indeed. Per capita vehicle miles traveled among young people is in complete freefall. And even when we adjust by economic group, young people who live in places where it is an option, a reasonable option to get around by some means other than a car, are doing so in droves. And from what we can tell, this is the result of a rather permanent attitude change. It turns out that my generation was the last generation to believe that owning my own car would bring me freedom, autonomy, social status, and sex. Today, there is something that brings young people all of those things, right? And it's the one thing that you're not allowed to use while driving. So this relationship between self-identity and automobile ownership appears to be permanently broken. That younger people are increasingly looking at the car as what it is. It is a mobility tool. Sometimes it's the right tool, sometimes it's not. But it, in terms of personal identity, I am a motorist, I love my car. No, I have a car, I use it when I need to get out of town or to go do big grocery shopping. But for the most part, like, it's more convenient and sociable and easy to, you know, walk or bike or take transit or grab a car share vehicle that's nicer than my car when I need it, right? So this is a fascinating and, it seems, permanent change, one that is not yet reflecting itself in travel demand models, which keep predicting that our children will behave like our parents, right? We know, if there's one thing that we know, it's that our children's generation will not behave like us, and let's hope that they don't. And this is reflected again in, you know, survey after survey. You just need to make sure that you're making adjustments to account for both the demographic changes in your community as well as your goals and your values. So once you have the sort of tools and performance metrics in place, the next thing to do is to start designing your community well. And as far as community design goes, the most important factor is to make sure that we put the needs of daily life within walking distance. And more importantly, to not only make that walk functional, but to make it delightful, to make it seductive, to make it the thing that people want to do because it's the nice and fun and beautiful thing to do. And we know how to do this. You know, every community on the peninsula has some of the most beautiful streets for walking. You can go to every single one, and yet in every single community on the peninsula in the South Bay, we all have seen streets that we would not be caught dead walking on. They're miserable, horrible places where the sidewalk is effectively, you know, weed control along the edge of the highway, right? We know how to design great streets, including great streets for really big streets like El Camino. I mean, even look at the Alameda in San Jose. You know, that's El Camino. It has the same traffic as other, you know, parts of El Camino. It's actually a lovely street to walk along. We know how to do this if only we would make it not only legal, but required to design great streets for pedestrians in all of our communities. There is never, ever an excuse for compromising the quality of the pedestrian experience in order to improve conditions for any other mode of transportation. This is really important. If you're compromising the quality of the pedestrian experience in order to make the buses work better, people need to be able to walk to the bus stop. And if your street is not a good pedestrian street, it is not going to work as a good transit street. Even compromising the quality of the pedestrian experience to improve conditions for driving is just making more people drive, right? This is actually the fundamental problem with over-reliance on intersection level of service, is that if we're slavishly adhering to improving conditions for cars at intersections, every time we improve level of service for cars at an intersection by widening it, we're making it that much more difficult to walk or bike or to take transit. It's not development that is necessarily causing our traffic congestion problem, in as much as it is the mitigations that we're applying to development to solve an overstated traffic congestion problem that doesn't exist. That the mitigations making our communities unwalkable, unbikeable, and dysfunctional for transit are forcing all of us to drive needlessly. For most of us, half of our trips are less than a mile. It would be very easy to eliminate half of our total motor vehicle trips if we could make our communities more delightful to walk and to bike in. Which relates to the next point. So, in a community of the density of a place like Sunnyvale, it's not going to be possible to put all of the needs of daily life within walking distance, let alone the needs of kind of weekly life. And so one of the most cost-effective ways to allow the suburban places to not be automobile dependent, indeed one of the most cost-effective ways to retool your community for changing market preferences, is to invest in its bikeability. Now this is a really important and fine point. I was at the Redwood City Council meeting on Monday. One of the council members said something very wise to me. He said, so Jeff, it seems like what you're saying is that when we're managing the city and the transportation system for today, we need to manage it for the needs of today's citizens. But when we're planning our capital investments, things that aren't going to be built for another decade, and things that are going to last for the next 100 years, we shouldn't be planning for today's citizens. We need to be planning for our future citizens and asking our future citizens what they want. And I thought this was very wise, because if any of you have ever talked to, my favorite control vehicle, my favorite design characteristic or design control is actually a 16-year-old girl. 16-year-old girls are old enough to be pretty wise of the world and to have very particular mobility needs and a lot of certainty about what they want. And they're fun to talk to, particularly about the future of transportation. I think I have a good handle on transportation and its future. 16-year-old girls have it way over on me. They know what they're talking about, and they know exactly what they want, and they want something very different than my generation. As somebody who's building projects that are going to be lasting for 100 years, it's my responsibility to make sure that I am designing for the right audience. And this is not actually all that different than managing a small business. So if I were to run my small business based only on what I wanted, I would quickly be out of business. I need to manage my business to at least make a profit by paying attention to my existing customers. But my customers that matter most to me, and the customers that will determine whether my business really succeeds, are my future customers, not my current customers. So thinking ahead to what your future customers here in the South Bay and the Peninsula want is extremely important as we design our communities for the future. And this is not to say ignore the people who are living here now. This is a democracy. The people who are living here now determine who runs the place, right? But all of you, as you're making decisions about those major future investment decisions, it's important for us to step out of our own immediate needs and try to predict what future generations want. And so one of the things that we need to pay attention to is not just the 30-year-old guys in Lycra as we're designing our cities for cycling, but the whole array of different cycling types, that our design cyclists should be this 8-year-old kid, or an 80-year-old woman with 2 sacks of groceries on her bike. If we can design for those people, we can design cities where everyone can bike. And there's nothing that makes cities safer for cyclists than getting more people out on bikes. And therefore, it's no wonder that the cities that are really succeeding in attracting significant numbers of cyclists are focusing, most importantly, on women, and also focusing on kids and older adults as well. If we can get them, everyone else will do it, because in fact, most Americans would really, really like to bike more, but they're afraid to bike on our current city streets. And it's no wonder, right? I wouldn't want to bike on most of the streets around here. But you've got the street right of way, and we now have the design techniques that can make almost any of us be able to get out on a bike, including many older adults for whom it's easier for them to bike because it's less impactful on their joints than it is for them to walk. And so focusing on that interested but concerned segment that is demanding separated bikeways on higher speed facilities and low speed traffic calm neighborhood greenways for other streets. And there's great examples all around us. San Jose is building this stuff. Palo Alto for 30 years has had the Bryant Street Bike Boulevard. We know how to do this, but we need to do more of it. And indeed, in cities all over the country that have invested in this, locally San Francisco is getting stupendous results. Davis, California has long been in this game. Santa Monica has seen a tripling in its bike rate. And even in New York City, one of the most hostile streets in the world for being out there on foot and on bike, putting in these separated bike facilities and designing them well has resulted not only in dramatic improvements to the rate of cycling, but improvements to safety for all users. And very interestingly, a 49% increase in retail sales. Because you know what? If you're on a bike, one, you can see the storefront. Two, it's really easy for you to park. Three, you have to shop more often, right? Because you can't carry a lot of stuff. Right. So this amazing phenomenon of being able to support our local communities by getting more people out on foot and on bike, something that we forget sometimes when we're just fixated on bike as infrastructure. Again, not everyone is going to be able to walk and bike. And so for longer trips, and particularly for trips in crowded corridors like El Camino, making transit fast, frequent, reliable, and most importantly, dignified is a necessary ingredient for a healthy and economically successful city of the future. And so we start with just the transit vehicle itself. And well, I guess this photo actually happens to be a tram. This is how France designs their buses, right? It's rather different than the way we design most of our buses in the United States. What do you notice about this? There's floor to ceiling clear glass. There's no advertising. Right? This transit vehicle actually encourages flirtation, right? One of the things that's really hard to do when you're driving a car, but if you're sitting there on the bus and you see somebody walking on the sidewalk, you can check that person out and be checked out yourself, and it may not lead to anything, but participating in this sort of urban promenade is what draws us to successful cities, right? We love seeing and being seen. We are fundamentally tribal social primates. We need a lot of social interaction in order to be happy. We need a lot of daily positive reinforcement in order to maintain a sense of our social status. This is biological. And if we ignore the needs, the biological needs of the human mind and our happiness, we will not make for happy cities. And similarly, the importance of transit has a lot to do not just, you know, with sort of quality of experience, but with geometry. Now, I have owned a car since the day of my 17th birthday. I got my driver's license on the morning of the day of my 16th birthday. I love driving. But I also recognize that every time I drive alone in my car, I am taking up more than 10 times as much roadway space per person than any other mode of transportation, right? So I've got this big space around me, that is my car. And in addition to that, there's the additional space between me and the next car, front and back and side to side. The magic of public transit is not just that it's providing an option for people who have no choice. The magic of public transit is that I can cram 10 times as many people in that same lane as I can without the bus. That in cities that are growing and that have existing traffic congestion, unless you are bulldozing neighborhoods to widen traffic lanes and add new highways through your community, unless you're bulldozing neighborhoods, you are reducing the amount of people that your street system can move unless you're investing in better and better transit. And this is not because the car is bad. The car is great. It's not about ideology. It's about geometry. The geometry of the car is inherently space inefficient. And so here we are in the South Bay. There's some opportunities. You know, you can spend another, you know, few $1 billion here and there to eke out a little bit of capacity here and there. You're not solving the problem. You're making it that much more difficult to walk and bike and take transit. If you want to solve the problem, as a matter of sheer mathematics, we have no choice but to make more efficient use out of our existing transportation infrastructure. And if we do, as has happened in, you know, cities all over the country, and again, I'm over-relying on data from New York, but you know, we're seeing the same thing in San Francisco and in San Jose, improving transit travel speed, improving the quality of the experience, improves its efficiency, gets you an increase in bus ridership, and indeed, again, improves retail sales. Again, because bus passengers are also pedestrians, and they're a captive market, and they shop more often, particularly locally. So in order to make walking, biking, and transit work, it is critical that you adopt the right street design manual. Most cities that I work in, their street design manuals are based upon a rural highway standard developed in the 1950s, and they haven't evolved much since. We know now that the techniques that work for improving motor vehicle safety on a rural highway are the opposite of the techniques that work on an urban street. On a rural highway, you know, you've got a sort of sleepy, distracted driver, you know, checking out his phone. You want the travel lane to be wider. You want there to be big shoulders and sweeping radii. So if the motorist is not really paying attention, that motorist won't run into a tree. Oh yeah, trees fix object hazards. That's what we call them in our industry. In an urban condition, the opposite is true. In an urban condition, ironically, we want to exacerbate the perception of danger in order to improve the performance of safety. This is very counterintuitive. If you think the road is horribly dangerous, likely if you look at the data, it's probably performing really well, because when you think the road is really dangerous, you slow down and you pay attention. Urban streets, all of them, are inherently very, very dangerous places. Every single one of them. And the data supports that we're killing tens of thousands of people a year on our streets. So techniques like narrowing traffic lanes, tightening up intersections, slowing down motor vehicles are critically important to the performance of our streets. And happily, a lot of work has been done just in the last decade, including the work of the North American Association of City Transportation Officials, a sort of counterbalance to the American Association of State Highway Transportation Officials, which wrote the Highway-Oriented Design Manual. The Urban Street Design Manual is something that all of your cities can adopt to use in your local jurisdiction. VTA just adopted it. San Francisco has. San Mateo has, some other cities have as well. I haven't kept track of the recent information. Easy for your city council to do and to provide clear direction and, very importantly, liability coverage for your traffic engineers to do the right design. You know, housing for cars is our most important value if you look at our design requirements for any city. We require there to be 3 to 5 housing units per automobile, but we don't actually require housing units for people. And so changing our approach to parking is really important. One thing to start with is to dispel some of the myths about parking meters and why we charge for parking. If your community is charging for parking in order to just raise revenue for the general fund, you are doomed. The reason we charge for parking is to make sure that customers and residents can find a parking space. We charge for parking the same reason why we charge for any other good or commodity in society, to balance supply and demand. Charging for parking is an extension of your customer attraction strategy. And so the first place that you need to start when you're having a conversation about charging for parking is making sure that you're using the right parking meter. Now, all parking meters need to accept forms of payment that normal humans have on their person. I'm not carrying quarters in my pockets right now. So in many cities, it's illegal for me to park. I do have a debit card and a credit card. All meters should take those. All meters should also call me up on my cell phone and ask if I want more time, because the other thing that meters do is they force me either to be a dupe or a criminal. I have to guess in advance how long I'm going to spend in your shopping district. If I guess that I'm going to spend more time than I thought, I've just been duped and cheated and gave me more of my money than was necessary for parking. If your shopping district is more fabulous than I thought, or if my date is going better than I expected, I have literally been criminalized. I come back to a criminal citation, right? I have to pay a criminal fine. This is craziness. No, all meters and meters in the modern world will call it like sending you a little text message. Hey, you know, your meter's about to expire. You know, press 1 to add 30 minutes, press 2 to add an hour. Easy to do. It's also important to recognize that everywhere I work that says they have a horrible, horrible parking crisis has plenty of parking, just not where people can find it. It costs, you know, $20,000 to $50,000 to build a parking space. It is always cheaper to use technology to help motorists find existing available spaces than it is to build new spaces. Use technology in your favor. Also, if you recognize that the reason we charge for parking is to create availability for customers and for residents, you need to charge the right price. Don Shoup, in his book, High Cost of Free Parking, recognized this, and your neighbor to the north, city of Redwood City, was the first place in the country to really implement this, to recognize that the right price for parking is always the lowest price that creates an availability target. The right price for parking is the lowest price that makes sure that there's a few spaces available in every block, in every parking lot, in every parking garage, at all times of day. So what that means is that the price on Main Street is going to be 2 to 3 times higher than the parking garage off of Main Street. The price on Main Street may be 5 times higher than the price on street 2 blocks away. So your price needs to vary based upon geography and demand. That also means that it needs to vary based upon time of day. This is from a meter in downtown Pasadena, California. You'll notice that Pasadena, it's an evening restaurant and entertainment district. They know on Friday and Saturday to charge for parking until midnight because people are still arriving at their thriving downtown until that time of day. You'll also notice that it does not say anywhere in Leviticus that parking needs to be free on Sundays. Parking is free on Sundays in most cities because they haven't updated their parking code since 1958, when stores were closed on Sundays. We charge for parking in order to create availability for customers. But your community will still accuse you of being evil money-grubbing bastards, which means you need to be very conscious about what happens to the net revenue that you raise from your parking program. Invest it in things that the place where you're raising the revenue cares about, just to get around the belief that We're charged with parking in order to gouge our motorists. It's a very bad way of managing a parking system. Other things to do with parking, make sure that you're unbundling the cost of parking from the cost of housing. Don't force households to buy more parking than they need. A household with one car should be able to afford more housing in your community. In fact, for every car a household can give up, that actually qualifies them for an additional $100,000 in mortgage. The adding a parking space to a residential unit increases the price of that unit by about 20 to 25% and decreases the number of units that you can build on a typical parcel by about 15 to 20%. Significant impact separating out the price of parking from the price of housing. It also allows your households that have many cars to buy as much parking as they need. Households don't have exactly, 2.0 cars. Then sort of pulling all this together, it's important to manage parking as part of a system and relate it to how you design your community. So imagine, this is El Camino, it's Lawrence Expressway, it's any of our horrible arterials we have here in Santa Clara County. And imagine land uses arrayed along that horrible arterial, and each land use comes with its separate parking lot. And you'll notice the parking lot is bigger than the land use, because that's what's required in your zoning code. And then imagine your daily life. And this is much simplified and compressed, but you drive your daughter to school and that requires a parking space, and then you go to work and you park there, and then you take your daughter to soccer practice because she can't get across the street, and then you do some shopping, and you meet your daughter, and you go home. And this is most people's daily lives, lots of driving, and lots of turning movements off of that big arterial that are disproportionately impacting congestion. Now imagine, instead, you arranged your community in a conventional downtown, like most of the historic cities in Santa Clara County, and you had your land uses arrayed on a main street, and you put the parking in the back, and you shared that parking. And so imagine the exact same trip. So you drive to your little downtown, you park, your daughter goes to school while you go to work, she can now take herself to soccer practice, you can pick up your errands and your lunch, and you can meet at your car, and you can go home. This is the exact same trip as the previous trip. This is not a transit trip. This is what we call a park once trip, and it has profoundly different results. It requires only half of the parking, because the parking is shared. That restaurant and retail and theater is having peak parking demand at a different time than the office. Half of the land area, or twice as much economic development opportunity. It's a quarter of the arterial trips, a sixth of the arterial turning movements, and less than a quarter of the vehicle miles traveled, or four times as much economic activity per unit of congestion than the other way of arranging your land use. By arranging your land uses around people rather than the car, and managing parking as the very expensive, complex system that it is, we can solve these problems, create better communities, and create happier, healthier people. But all of it requires doing what is my final point, which is creating a new vision of the city. When we are asked to imagine a picture of the city in the future, most of us come up with imagery that is either rooted in the 1964 Hanna-Barbera cartoon, The Jetsons, or in the 1933 and 39 World's Fair exhibits, Futurama. We believe in this sort of modernist view that somehow technology is going to be able to transform us, give us sort of unlimited freedom and social autonomy, social status and autonomy and sex. Those things are not, however, what make us happy. We know what makes us happy. Our social lives, our friends, our families, exercise, and really, I would argue, more importantly, beauty. The only thing that the human brain, the only experience that the human brain never tires of, is beauty. And the other interesting factor about beauty is that it makes us cherish things and places. We maintain the things that we cherish. We protect them. And if you would agree that in the world of sustainability, whether we're looking at energy conservation or water conservation or CO2 reduction, there is nothing more effective, there's no more effective approach for improving sustainability in our communities than maintaining what we already have. I would argue that A thing or a place is fundamentally not socially, not ecologically, and certainly not economically sustainable if it is not beautiful. So define for yourself what is beauty and what would make your community more beautiful. And most importantly, think ahead to the lives of your grandchildren, your great-grandchildren, and what kind of a place you hope that they can live in. With that, I would be happy to take some questions.
What happens when the identity of the automobile that we grew up with now turns into the identity of a bicycle? It costs $10,000.
Well, I think, you know, one of the things working at Disneyland taught me is that it's okay to love transportation. Transportation is really fun. Transportation as a hobby is fantastic. You know, I think 15 years from now, owning a car will be about the same as owning a plane or a boat today. A lot of people really love boating, and for a long time from here on out, people will continue to love driving. That it will be something that people do for pleasure, and because the love of the design of automobiles, the sort of experience of driving, particularly on a country road, you know, driving up to Miranda or Yosemite or wherever people go. But 15 years from now, you know, when I'm an old guy, talking to, you know, some young people and have them ask me, so, you know, great granddaddy, like, is it true that in the olden days, people actually drove their own cars? And I'll say, well, you know, yes, in fact, and, you know, it was a lot of fun, it was great. And she'll say, but, you know, great-granddaddy, like, doesn't that mean that, like, wasn't that dangerous? Like, well, yeah, in fact, you know, tens of thousands of people died every year as a result of this activity. And she'll just shake her head and crazy, you know, and think about how crazy those olden days were. Even as she might, you know, continue to admire watching old movies of, you know, car chases and things, and, you know, be excited about that. So I think it's perfectly fine to have, to latch on with affection to modes of transportation. And to celebrate modes of transportation in our culture, but not to equate our own personal identity and social status, to not have them be a substitute for how we present ourselves in the world. That owning a car doesn't make me a better or more powerful person. It may allow me, however, to have a lot more fun on a Sunday afternoon. Other questions? Yes, in the very back.
Hi. Thanks for the inspiration. I wanted to just first clarify something. I work for BK. We haven't yet adopted the NACTO.
Oh, you
haven't? No, we haven't. Oh. But we're exploring the options. And I just had a question. For the suburban community, like Sunnyvale, who have a lot of great ideas, it's kind of scary to jump in. How would you suggest tiptoeing the water tone of the water? What
yes.
are like one or two things that Sunnyvale would think about?
That's a really important question. So doing these sorts of transitions is the hardest thing that any elected official in this room will ever do. And I sympathize. So there's a lot of tricks that cities have learned along the way, including tricks for cities more like Sunnyvale. I apologize for using too many examples from New York, but their data is just so good. One of the first things to remember is that, particularly if you're starting off with paint, streets are really easy to change, right? You can experiment, and if it, you know, you collect the before data, you collect the after data, if it's not working out, you can adjust. And if it's still not working out, you can say, well, okay, that didn't work, let's try something else. So the pilot project approach is really, really important. Another thing to recognize is that many of our residential streets are overscaled and not working very well for the people who live along those streets. So always a good place to start is by rethinking residential streets to make them more quality places. Street trees, sidewalk widenings, traffic calming improvements, what we call neighborhood greenways,
Those are sorts of projects that, while they may be a sort of part of a citywide bike strategy, benefit everyone. They improve residential property values and quality of life if they're done well, they improve the walkability of a neighborhood, and they improve bikeability all at the same time. It's a everyone wins solution. And it starts to build the case for more and more of that. Another place that's really important to start that is incredibly effective in suburban locations is around schools, doing safe routes to schools programs. Even the most sort of recalcitrant, old school, like Americans like to drive kind of person and everyone always drives, you show up at a council hearing with a bunch of school kids in tow and have the kids say, I'm afraid to walk to school. Can you please help me walk to school? That's really hard to argue against. And again, it's the sort of thing that if you design your Safe Routes to Schools program to not only benefit kids walking and biking to school, but the larger community as well, you start, again, creating the constituency for larger programs. Another place to start is not taking on the whole arterial, but the arterial crossings, making it easier and safer to get from one residential neighborhood to the next, particularly here in Santa Clara County where there's a sort of pattern of the half mile big arterial. One of the greatest obstacles here in Santa Clara County, it's fine to sort of walk and bike within a neighborhood, but impossible to get to the store because you've got to get across the arterial. So identifying those key crossing locations and fixing them. But in order to get those usable, mapping and wayfinding then also become really important. Some of the most cost-effective tools that I've seen in a lot of cities is simply destination wayfinding. Noting key destinations in your community and putting up simple signs that say, hey, did you know that Santana Row is only a 15-minute walk from here? Right? It sort of blows people's minds, because so many of our driving trips are really short driving trips. And there are many neighborhoods here in the county where there are actually pedestrian shortcuts. But if you're in a car all the time, you may not know where that pedestrian shortcut exists. So those are, many of the low-hanging fruit. There are others, including quality improvements to the transit system, oftentimes done, as a public-private partnership. And Santa Clara County has been one of the best places in the country for experimenting with involving the private sector in helping to make transit work better. Lots more opportunities for that. Other questions? Yes, sir.
Nelson Nygaard is involved with the Packard Foundation 3 years ago, putting together a parking management plan for them. Have you been tracking that? Because my understanding is they're doing very well.
I have not. My colleague Patrick Sigmund did that project, and he probably has the data. I don't have that off my finger.
So they had, by formula, they were required to have 151 parking spaces, and I closed it. They could get probably 67, and they're doing it.
Great. Well, that's good. Another data point, right?
Yes.
Right.
Don't have to go to New York.
Parking is one of these things where that in the transportation profession we pretend like what we do is science, and there's this giant book called Parking Generation. It's really, really thick, and it has kind of every imaginable land use in it. And you sort of open it up, it's like this dictionary, and you turn and you search through the different land uses, and it has all of this data in it. But if you don't read pages 1 through 5. That says all of the data in this book is from isolated single-use locations with no pedestrian or transit accessibility. And the data is collected, mainly in Florida in the 1970s. It doesn't provide you any guidance with applying that to your local conditions. And traffic engineers treat it as if it's, the Talmud. It's the sacred text that, has to be respected. It's in parking generation. The facts, collect your own data. It's actually not that hard, and it's going to be much more relevant than anything that you get in one of these giant books with data from Florida in the 1970s. You had a question? Yeah.
All right. I have a question.
Yes, over here.
So there are different reasons people drive or not drive. There's time, convenience, the money. But one important thing is safety.
Absolutely.
I don't bike myself. Not only am I concerned of my safety, but also I don't want to lock or park my bike in somebody steal it, and how can we address that? Because that's very important in San Jose. A lot of students want to bike, and even on the campus, these bikes get stolen.
But there are many, many factors that need to come together in order to support a significant number of people making a different choice than the typical choice. And we've gone to great lengths to make sure that the typical choice will always be the trip by car. So San Jose State University spends a fortune ensuring that there are plenty of parking spaces for people who drive, even though it's significantly more expensive to build a car parking space than a secure bike parking space. Similarly, we spend an enormous amount of money making sure that it's physically possible and easy for you to drive from your house to the campus in a car by, you know, providing lane. You know, the lane is not, you know, 6 feet wide, it's 14 feet wide, and, you know, the signals all work and they're visible from your car. None of the design considerations that we use for a typical street have the cyclist in mind. So our challenge, as we're trying to make more efficient use of our street space, is to rethink all of those things that for the last 60 years we've been going out of our way to accommodate one mode of transportation, doing the same thing for the other modes of transportation, recognizing that they are cheaper, they're more space efficient, they help tremendously with social equity outcomes, you know, because they're more affordable, and available to people of a broader array of ages and abilities. But it's a challenge. We've got to kind of get all of them together. So we need to make sure that there's a route that you can take that you do feel safe and comfortable, that is either a very low-speed residential street where motorists will respect you on your bike, to make sure that when you have to get on the higher-speed street that you're separated from traffic, to make sure that you're not the only one out there, so that you feel a sense of personal security that nobody's going to do something terrible to you. That there's a place, a convenient place for you to park your bike where you can be reasonably assured that your bike will still be there when you get back. That, you know, there be adequate lighting and signage, that there be some weather protection, that if it's raining, that you can figure out, okay, well, maybe I can wear a rain suit, but that there's a place to deal with your rain suit when you get there, or if you're too sweaty, that you can shower off, you know, and so on and so on and so on. Fortunately, throughout Santa Clara County, there are efforts that are being made in almost all the cities here to start putting that whole chain back together again for bikes. But I recognize that we're a long ways from there, and you should never feel guilty about not driving, or you should never feel guilty about driving, right? One thing that we know for sure in the sort of world of consumer choice, advertisers, you will notice, never use guilt to make you buy their product, right? You know, Coca-Cola doesn't make you feel guilty for buying Pepsi. They make you believe that somehow your life is going to be more fun and sociable and, you know, elevated if you, you know, buy their sugary product rather than somebody else's sugary product. We need to do the same for transportation. We need to make biking or taking transit or walking, whatever it is, seem like, you know, the fun and right and sensible thing to do, not make us feel guilty because the conditions are such that the only reasonable choice is driving. Yes, ma'am.
Could you talk a little bit about
Okay, I'll take you and then one more question.
It seems like the same piece is the lack of data that actually tracks pedestrians and bicycles and where they go and how far they go and how much they go and all that. And you said, well, collect your own data. Could you expand on that a little bit? Are you talking about a methodology that's already out there, an app or something?
So the data collection world is changing so rapidly, and it's great. So companies like AirSage, are spying on me at this very moment and observing how this device is moving around in space by applying this in, you know, a map and observing the speed and speed differentials. They can actually sort out what mode somebody is most likely using and trace the entire path and have this massive amount of data, not just for the 20% of our trips that are journey to work,
but the other 80% of our trips that are, you know, errands and shopping and picking up our kids and doing all the other things that we're doing. Cities are only beginning to figure out what on earth to do with this data and what it means and how to help us make more efficient choices, but it's unlocking this opportunity to make profound differences and to use our money more wisely in ways that benefit more people. So it's a very good time for data. I think we better wrap up.
Yeah.
All right, I can stick around for a little bit longer. But thank you all. You've been a fantastic audience.